Hi, I'm Gerardo from AWS.
Hi, I'm Rohit from Verana Health, and this is my architecture.
So Rohit, can you tell me about Verana and what this architecture is solving for?
Yeah, so as a company, Verana Health today ingests data for patients' data set. Mm-hmm. We not only get patients' data, but we get provider and location data set. And the outcome of it is we curate that data set and create Q data modules, which are then used for real world experiences, life sciences, and then trial data set.
Okay, so can you run me through the components of this architecture?
Sure. So as you see, this is one of our S3 bucket where we store all our Q data modules. Now the Q data modules can be specific to a disease, can be specific to an indicator itself.
Okay. Right?
Once those data set are uploaded into the S3 bucket, we use Airflow as our orchestration tool, and you know, we upload the data set into the staging environment for that.
Okay.
And then it follows its pipeline process.
Okay, so you have a pipeline for automating all of these steps, is
yes.
that right?
Yes.
Okay, so what can you tell me about what's happening inside of this Redshift cluster?
Right, so we pull from S3 bucket, uploads into an staging environment, then the second step is to run a validation. Mm-hmm. On the data set, which are uploaded into the staging environment. Mm-hmm. That's where we do all our validation and making sure that data is ready and approved to go to production.
Okay.
And then if the pipeline at the step two is successful, then we upload that data set into production itself.
Okay. So what sort of validations are you running and how long do they take?
Right. So the validation step take at least 2 to 3 hours and depending on the data set itself. So if we have in GBs, it takes 3 hours max, and if it is more than the GBs, it goes into terabyte, then it will take that much amount of time.
Okay.
In order to talk about validations, this particular task is again divided into multiple subtasks where we look at what kind of schema is uploaded into staging environment. Is it matching with the schema which we want to upload on data exchange itself?
Mm-hmm.
It also look at the primary and foreign key relationship between the multiple tables we have. And it also looks at the column data type validation itself to make sure that there is no problem when we upload the data set into production, which already has that schema. Because the first time there won't be any schema, but the second time when we do the data refresh, it's basically you're uploading a second version of the data set itself, right? And then at that validation step itself, we have certain alerts set up on Slack. So if any of this three subtasks fail, our data engineering team gets an alert. Mm-hmm. And the pipeline stop processing there itself.
Okay.
And then the data engineers go back, look at the data set, make sure that was that a problem with schema, was there a problem with foreign key and primary key relationship. They fix that data set and then they rerun the pipeline.
Okay, so look, the fact that they take hours to process these validations, it makes me wonder, did you choose Redshift because of the performance that it can give you for those long processing queries?
Yes. So there were two reasons we chose Redshift. One was that we are running the validation on the Redshift instance itself.
Mm-hmm.
That was one. The second is, as we are growing, we will have multiple customers coming to us, subscribing to our data set, and we wanted to use Redshift so that it can grow horizontally itself.
Okay.
And we don't have to go look back into the infrastructure and see is our customer having a problem, because we do have set up a lot of monitoring on our Redshift.
Mm-hmm.
That helps us to know how much space is growing on it, what kind of CPU and memory are on the Redshift instance. Yeah.
And are you managing the scaling yourself or are you using the serverless version?
We are using the serverless version on it.
Right. Okay, so once your data sets are ready for production, what happens next?
So the next step is more of like a manual step, because we have made sure that the data set is uploaded to production, which is all automated. But now the part comes is where we have to upload the documentation.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a part where it is more manual.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have to make sure that we cover what kind of data set we are uploading, what kind of version that data set uploads it has. And then it also tells a little bit story about if we have changed any of the schema version. Mm-hmm. On the data set itself.
Okay, so can you give me an overview of what data exchange is doing for you and how does that compared to how you were doing it in the past?
So that's where AWS Data Exchange is helping us. Is we have one pane of glass where all the customers subscribe to our data set. Mm-hmm. We don't have to produce this multiple set of SFTP and S3 buckets. And we just use Redshift where the data is uploaded. Customers are subscribed through Data Exchange where they have choices where they can either download the data set mm-hmm. or they can consume that data set directly onto their Redshift data share itself. So that okay. if you see, it becomes like a copy of whatever tables you have in our Redshift instance becomes a copy into their instance itself.
That makes sense. So what happens when one data set gets updated? How often do they get updated?
Every 2 weeks.
Okay. And do customers that are subscribed to that data set get that data automatically? How does that work?
Right. So on AWS Data Exchange, when we onboard a customer, mm-hmm. there is a way where you can set up your notifications. So you can get an email. You can also get a Slack alert for it.
Look, I love how you've automated this data pipeline end to end, not only from the way that you prepare your production data, but also even the way that your customers subscribe to your data.
Right.
So thank you very much for sharing this architecture with us.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. This is My Architecture. See you next time.